Hello, I'm Alex Davies, founder of Wealth Club, and today I'm with Nicholas Sharp of Hambro Perks to talk about their Growth EIS Fund. Hi Nick, welcome. Tell me about Hambro Perks and also give me some background to yourself.
Hi Alex, thank you very much for having me. So Hambro Perks is an established venture capital firm based in London. Everything which we do is in unlisted private companies. We have total assets of around £350 million. At our heart, we are venture capitalists. We're looking to support great founders building companies that we believe have the ability to be very valuable, primarily through solving problems that we consider to be global problems.
And tell me about yourself.
So I joined Hambro Perks in 2017, specifically to build this EIS product. So the fund itself is around 4 years old now, approaching 4 years. Within Hambro Perks, we have experience over many decades of venture capital investing. My entire career has been in finance. I started out at, as was then, Deloitte & Touche, went into helping to run publicly listed equity funds and spent some time in investment banking as well.
And your EIS growth fund, what does it aim to do?
So we are looking to make great returns for our investors. Every investment we make, obviously, is in EIS-eligible businesses. We look to make 10 to 15 investments for each of our investors over a period of 12 to 18 months. And over time, we look to return 3 times their money, excluding the EIS reliefs.
OK, and are there any particular characteristics you look for in companies?
There are. So almost everything we do is technology-enabled. We're looking primarily for amazing founders. So we're looking for people that we think have the grit and determination and crucially the domain expertise to build businesses that we think can be very valuable. They'll be solving a problem that we understand, that we think is a global problem. The businesses in which we invest are on the whole technology enabled, and there are 4 verticals that we look to invest in. One is financial technology. I would include insurance in that, B2B software, digital health and wellness, and broadly consumer digital. Now those sound like very broad and they cover what sounds like most of the market. But within each of those, we have very specific requirements that we're looking for. So financial technology, for example, there's been a huge amount of technological disruption already in the finance space. Think about the neobanks, for example. You know, much of this is already done and we're not looking to make fresh investments in areas where there are already existing successful businesses. We're narrowing down these broader sectors to find areas where we believe there's an emerging business model or there's something interesting in some area that is particularly ripe for disruption. So it sounds very broad. In fact, it's very narrow within each of those spaces that we look at.
And where do you typically get your deals from?
So deal sourcing is one of our key indicators. We spend a huge amount of time. This year we'll see around 4,000 opportunities. The funnel is, at the top, very broad. We narrow that down. So of those 4,000, we're likely to meet for the first time 500, 600, 700. Of those, we will take probably 200 through to a second meeting. And after that, we'll then be doing a lot of work, serious DD, on maybe 50. After that, we'll take 20 to 25 to investment committee, and we'll make 10 to 15 investments. So unfortunately, we spend a lot of our time saying no to often great entrepreneurs, and that's the sad part of our job. Where those 4,000 come from, there's 4 main areas. First of all, there's inbound. That's not really adding any value. Every VC has inbound. We're in that flow like everybody else. Alongside that, we do a significant amount of thematic research. At any time, we will have a member of the team working on an area that we think is interesting. From that research, we will then make outbound outreach to those companies that we think fit what we're looking for. We also have a data scientist in the team who spends time scraping publicly available information, looking for signals. It could be new company formation, it could be senior people leaving existing successful businesses and looking to start up on their own. And we look for signals in that data to make approaches to people and companies we think look interesting and meet our criteria. We also have a very, very extensive network, of course. And part of the benefits of having decades of expertise and experience in the space is that we have come across and worked with an awful lot of people. And warm referrals and introductions are a key part of the opportunities that we find.
And how early stage are you going?
So we will invest very early stage, as long as the founding team is in place, and it's normally a team, on occasion a solo entrepreneur, but normally we're looking for teams. We will invest pre-revenue, but even in those situations, we will be looking for evidence, some kind of indication that revenues are likely to come in the relatively near term. So that could be some very early degree of customer acceptance, sign-ups for trials, etc. We invest from that pre-seed through to around Series A. Most of the Series A investments that we make will be follow-ons from existing companies in the portfolio. And that's part of our model. We like to find amazing founders early, support them along their journey, and invest in subsequent rounds as they continue to raise capital.
Okay, do you want to talk to me about some of the recent investments you've made?
Sure. So,
and why?
Well, maybe if I take a couple. So a recent Series A follow-on, a great example of that would be Peppy Health. So this is a company that we first invested in at seed in 2020. We met the team and they were doing something that we thought was incredibly interesting. So they enable employers to provide support for their employees at the difficult and challenging stages in their life that everybody goes through, but which are not normally covered by other benefits such as private medical insurance. So a good example in the first product they had was around menopause support. Alongside that, they had fertility and also postnatal. And they've just launched a men's health. So they're providing for those employees the support they need to help get them through these difficult times. And that could be anything from chatting with practitioners to having video calls with practitioners to interacting in group chats. It's a very, very powerful model that is doing incredibly well. So when we first invested at the beginning of 2020, this was a business that had an amazing team, three of them. The very earliest stages of revenue generation, revenues were minimal. Over the following year and a half, they took those revenues from very minimal to now they're in the millions per year. And the Series A earlier this year, we were very, very proud to be part of as well.
And any other recent examples?
Yes. So another recent example is in a business called Sust Global. Now, this is a climate risk analytics tool. It essentially ingests huge amounts of data, geospatial, local weather data, long-term climate data, and it produces an intelligent model that enables analysts or owners of assets to understand the impact on those assets, particularly the value of those assets over time. So this was a bootstrap business, two incredibly energetic and mission-driven founders. One of the key things which made us incredibly impressed was the fact that they had built an enormous amount of credibility and following, having simply bootstrapped the business over a relatively short period of time. So in terms of indicators for future success, you know, their very first customer is the London Stock Exchange, which is looking to incorporate some of this climate data alongside the financial data that they sell to their customers. So very, very interesting and important business.
And do you want to talk about some of the companies you've held for a longer period?
Sure. So going back a couple of years, a business called PrimaryBid we invested in the summer of 2019. So this is a business that enables individuals to participate in listings and placings by listed companies when they issue more equity to raise capital. So historically, when a company, for example, a FTSE listed company, raises capital at a discount to the prevailing share price, only institutions have access to those placings. Given that many of those companies have significant retail shareholder base, that is really not fair. Mm-hmm. PrimaryBid exists to enable retail to participate in those on the same terms as the institutions. So this hits a number of our themes. You know, it's financial inclusion and it's the democratization of finance, particularly of the sort of very closed shop of the city financial world. So when we met this business, from my background as well, I had a very clear understanding. I've been on both sides of placings and also participating in those placings. So I could see the problem, and this business is doing incredibly well. They've launched in Europe. The next stop, I think, will be the US, doing very well. Another company we invested in is an insurance technology business called Humn. So insurance, I don't think it's controversial to say, is one of the last big, truly global industries that has really only had the surface scratched in terms of what technology can do to improve the efficiency. Humn is a vehicle insurance business, particularly focused on fleets. Now, I think the first wave of disruption in insurance was around fractionalizing the existing insurance product. So, for example, if you are a moped courier, you want to be insured while you are delivering, but not when you're not delivering, when you're not working. So this is breaking up an existing, pretty standard insurance policy into bits that only apply when you're actually using your vehicle. And we think of that as being insured when you drive. Now, in our view, the next phase of disruption in this industry and technological advance will be being insured how you drive. So a business called Humn effectively takes huge amounts of data, telematics from the car, geospatial data, local weather conditions, and it takes those and it calculates your premium based on how you are driving at that particular point in time and the risk that you are incurring at that point in time, and is able to price your insurance in real time. Now, there are two impacts of this. First is it's a more effective and usually cheaper insurance premium. most insurance premiums are based on historic averages and tend to be too high. The other aspect of this is that it incentivizes higher quality driving. And this also becomes a flywheel that reduces the cost of your premium. So this is very, very powerful. Over time, I think as individuals start to lease their cars in more more aggressive ways. At the moment, obviously, people buy cars on lease, but it's normally a one-to-one lease arrangement. I think in time, particularly with autonomous vehicles, etc., people are going to be leasing cars to a far greater extent. And so I think this can move from commercial vehicle fleets to individual car ownership as well.
So you've only been around since 2017 doing this. So is it too early for exits?
It is a little bit early for exits. We're working towards exits in some of our companies. Now, across Hambro Perks as a whole, we have many exits in various track records, but none within this product. Having said that, we expect to make the bulk of returns to our investors in the 4 to 7 year time period, so we're only just approaching that now. And we have a number of companies that have added and created an enormous amount of value and where we think there is the chance for exits in the near future. So none yet within the fund, but coming, and within Hambro Perks, a long track record of exits.
And have you had any failures yet?
It's a feature of the type of investing that we do that we will have failures. So by investing early and looking for the very high multiple returns, we're taking on risk. And unfortunately, some of the companies that we invest in will not make it. We have had failures. There are two so far. There will, of course, be more. If we don't have failures, then we're not taking the amount of risk that we should be. The vast majority of returns for each investor's portfolio will come from a relatively small number of holdings. Of every, let's say, 15 holdings that we have, probably the bulk of returns will come from three or four of those, and you could probably expect a similar number of failures as well. This, I think, is representative of the VC industry as a whole, in the sense that the majority of returns from venture capital will accrue to a relatively small number of all the venture capital investments that are made. For every unicorn that's made, there's a long tail of failures or companies that don't perform as hoped, and I think that will be reflected within the fund as well.
And in general, Nick, what are your biggest challenges as an EIS manager?
Well, so I think there are two areas that we really focus on. I think they differentiate us. The first is finding the opportunities, and the second is winning the opportunities. The truth is that the best deals, you know, the best founders have access to multiple sources of capital. It is competitive. We have to demonstrate the expertise. We're constantly learning, and we're constantly showing that we have the expertise to help businesses grow. I think those are really the two challenges for any venture capital firm, and I think on both of those we stand out. We spend a huge amount of time sourcing opportunities, we spend a huge amount of time developing ourselves as well, so that we can help the companies that we invest in, and that in itself becomes a flywheel to bring more opportunities to us.
And finally, a quick elevator pitch. Why should someone looking to invest in an EIS this tax year consider Hambro Perks?
Well, again, I think it comes down to the nexus of opportunity and expertise. The truth is that the vast majority of venture capital returns across the industry as a whole will come from a very small proportion of investments that are made. And we spend all our time trying to make sure that we have a high proportion of those investments within our fund. So even when we find the opportunities, we have to win them. And this really comes down to the expertise and the network that we have built. So in my view, we have the ability to create and generate extraordinary returns for our investors using the expertise that we have, which is very hard to replicate. It takes a lot of time to build this up. And so it's where those two factors come together, and that's really where we're sitting. And that's why I think that we have the opportunity to make immense returns for our investors.
Nicholas Sharp of Hambro Perks, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.